Good afternoon, NACI members and friends. This is Leah Deppert speaking. I'm the Director of Marketing and Communications for NACI. Thank you so much for joining us today for our March webinar on 5 ways to empower your students with IP education. On the line with me, I have a few important guest speakers, but before I go ahead and get to them, I did just want to go over a few housekeeping items. Number one, this webinar is being recorded, so if you would like to listen to this at a later time or share it with a friend, please know that you will receive these slides as well as the recording in about 20 hours from now. If you are a NACI member that's listening, you can always access all of our webinars on our webinar archive. As well, we do encourage you to submit your questions and comments. We do want this to be as interactive as possible, so there's two great ways to go ahead and do that. Number one is via the questions feature on your GoToWebinar dashboard. Those come directly to me as the organizer. If it makes sense for me to interrupt the presenter, I will do so, but I plan to hold a majority of the questions until the very end of the webinar. As well, you can also type in your questions or comments via the chat feature on your GoToWebinar dashboard. Just know that you have to preference that those just go to the organizer, to the panelists, or else they will go to everyone on the webinar right now. Like I already mentioned, the Q&A will happen during the last 5 to 10 minutes, but we do encourage you to type in those questions and comments as you think of them so that you don't forget them. And then lastly, we encourage you to share any insights or interesting learnings that you hear today on the webinar with the hashtag NACI member webinar and tag NACI as well. So today's discussion, we are going to cover a lot of different topics on IP education, but wanted to go over two main points of learning. Number one, we really want you all to gain a better understanding of the free plug and play, easy to use into IP or intellectual property resources available to you and your students. We know that a lot of you already use MichelsonIP.com, but we're happy to share today more of other resources that you might be able to share or further use those in your classrooms. As well, we want you to be able to ask your questions and get those answers on how you can successfully utilize all of their great materials in your classroom, SBDC, Makerspace, and more. So like I mentioned earlier, we do have a few great presenters on the line today. Number one, I wanted to first start off by introducing Jelani Adlam. She's the program manager for the Michelson Foundation. I've been working with Jelani for the past couple years. She's an absolute joy to work with. We've started our partnership with the foundation a few years ago in partnership with Santa Monica College. And unfortunately, both Nathan Cleal and Salvias are not able to join us today due to all of the craziness that is happening in regards to the coronavirus, which I'm sure everyone on the line is in a bit of a frenzy trying to get their classes all online or figure out what's happening. So we really appreciate and value your time, but I'm proud to be able to introduce Jelani and can't wait to hear more from her today. So Jelani, if you want to do a quick introduction, and then I will turn it over so that you can share your slides.
Yes, absolutely. Thanks, Leah, so much for the introduction. We are thrilled to be partnered with NACI here. And thanks to everyone who's joined us on the line today. We really hope that you're all doing well in this hectic and really unprecedented time. And thank you all so much for taking the time to join us today for this webinar. Leah, just checking in with you if you can see my screen okay?
Yep, it looks great.
Okay, awesome. So again, to introduce myself, my name is Jelani Adlam, and I'm a program manager at the Michelson 20mm Foundation. For those who are not yet familiar with us, we are a private family foundation based in downtown Los Angeles, and we work to support higher education institutions, nonprofits, entrepreneurs, startups in building new technologies and working on new models with the promise of improving post-secondary access, affordability, and equity. And I would say that really a common thread among all of our initiatives is education as empowerment. That's what I always say. And so the Michelson Institute for Intellectual Property, or Michelson IP, is one of our flagship initiatives at 20mm. Since 2016, our vision has been to address critical gaps in the world of intellectual property education. Our founder is Dr. Gary K. Michelson. He's a prolific inventor whose career as an orthopedic spinal surgeon really propelled him to turn to innovation to solve challenges. And today he holds over 950 patents worldwide. So, you know, very, very aware and passionate about the role of intellectual property in society today. And so our goal is really to empower the next generation of creators and inventors with intellectual property education and the knowledge that they'll need to capitalize on their innovations and to really capitalize on the great value that they're creating and understand how to protect that. And so before we go into the presentation, we wanna have a quick poll just to get a sense of the group that's joined us today. So Leah, if you're able to launch that now, we have a first question. So our first question, have you previously taught lessons or classes on intellectual property?
I'll just give folks about a few more seconds and then I'll share the results.
Okay, great.
Okay, it looks like 33% are yes and 67% are no.
Okay, great. That's very useful information. So the majority have no experience teaching intellectual property in a classroom setting or co-curricular setting at this point. And then the next question we have for you all is, what is your level of expertise more broadly on the subject matter of IP, whether or not you, you've taught IP previously?
Now just give folks about 10 seconds to go ahead and answer that, and then I'll share the responses. Alrighty, so it looks like we have about 40% are novice, 30% are intermediate, 20% are advanced, and 10% are expert.
Okay, awesome. That's a cool mix. Great. So Leah, can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. So thanks everyone for sharing about your experience in those polls. So talking a little bit about IP and the knowledge economy to kick us off, you know, today IP's imprint is really everywhere and touches everyone. And I always like to stress that it's not only Fortune 500 companies that this affects, but really startups, individual creators, and consumers also. IP accounts for more than 80% of the market value of publicly traded companies and represents 38% of total US GDP. And over the last 60 years, nearly every major new industry has been launched due to IP-protected innovations. And now they are really the principal driver of corporate value as well as national economic growth. And, you know, something that we still see is that as important as the topic of intellectual property is, it's often left out of the undergraduate educational discourse. And we see this even in the context of entrepreneurship. And so when we talk about the IP education gap, this is really the idea that despite IP's importance, few of our colleges or universities offer undergraduate courses on the basic workings or role of patents, copyright, trademarks, and trade secrets. And IP is largely still taught primarily in law schools and in business school. And we see this as a big gap because IP is relevant to almost every academic discipline, almost every field of work. And so at Michelson IP, we want to look at this gap also as an opportunity to step up and to fill this need that we see in the market and for our students. So today I want to walk you all through five ways that you can utilize our resources to introduce the topic of IP to your students and your communities, and particularly those with ambitions of entrepreneurship, and empower them with the awareness of and literacy in intellectual property topics. And so the five areas we're going to talk about today: integrating IP curriculum into courses, and especially those, you know, across academic disciplines. We're going to talk about using IP education materials in co-curricular settings, sharing self-paced online resources for IP with your students, how to embed digital IP materials into your online resources, and also how to apply to host a hacking IP event in partnership with us. And I also want to point out, just before we dive in, that everything we create is openly licensed and is available at no cost. So all of our activities are underwritten by the foundation, and this relates back to our mission of improving access in education and our commitment to open educational resources. So first off, integrating IP curriculum into courses across academic disciplines. One of the first projects of Michelson IP was actually to collaborate with some of the brightest minds in the field to develop a publisher quality open textbook. This foundational text is called The Intangible Advantage: Understanding Intellectual Property in the New Economy. And we really see it as the first ever popular text on IP that's written for ordinary citizens with no legalese vocabulary, and particularly with a focus on supporting undergraduate students. So the lead author for the text is a Pulitzer Prize nominated IP expert named David Klein, and the former Undersecretary of Commerce and former Director of the Patent Office, David Kapos, served as the executive editor. And the book it's interactive. It includes learning assessment tools and a series of short animated videos on the various intellectual property topics. And on our online faculty portal, which we'll talk about in a second, we have some sample course outlines which show how the book has been adapted into different courses. For example, Law for the Entrepreneur at Santa Monica College. And those outlines include learning objectives, student learning outcomes, sample assignments, and course content details. In addition to the book, we also have a pre-built plug-and-play curriculum that's available on our free educator portal. So this portal is a really simple and easy to access webpage that we actually launched as a result of the initial pilot phase that we had with NACI. And that's where you can access the comprehensive library of IP learning materials. They've been designed, again, to really offer a valuable foundation on patents, copyright, trademarks, and trade secrets for a range of fields. So that includes business, marketing, digital media, art, music. And we have a full curriculum, which could be its own standalone 3-unit course, for example. But we also have the light and ultralight versions, which are a lighter touch if you want to expose students to the topic of IP within the context of your course, but can't necessarily commit to a ton of time on the topic of IP. So it's broken out in a modular format, so you can kind of build it up and down as you would like. And you'll find LMS course cartridges and PowerPoint presentations, among other resources. I'd encourage you all to sign up for a free account today. That's at michelsonip.com/teachip. And again, our master shell on the educator portal is compatible with all learning management systems, but it was built for Canvas. So It ports in very easily to Canvas. We're now looking to build the course cartridge out specifically for Blackboard as well. So we've had a lot of feedback from colleges, particularly outside of California, that Blackboard is still the LMS that many of the colleges are using at this time. So now talking a little bit about some of the materials that you can use in co-curricular settings. So, you know, whether that be a special IP clinic or presentation, or even a lunch and learn on a topic related to entrepreneurship, maybe not necessarily IP, but an entrepreneurship topic. I think our 9-part Basics of IP video series is a great resource for that type of setting. These are introductory videos which talk about patents, copyright, and trademarks in a more bite-sized learning format. They're 3 to 5 minute animated videos that students tend to really love and engage with. And you can find those on our website. We also have those available on YouTube and Vimeo. And so now I actually want to play a quick clip from one of these videos. It's called Can I Trademark That? And we'll just play a quick clip for you to get a sense.
Say you've got a great idea for a business and you'd like to trademark it. The first thing you need to know is that you can't trademark a mere business idea. Trademarks are only granted to companies actually engaged in business. What exactly is a trademark? A trademark is a word, name, symbol, or device, or combination of above that identifies the source of a product or service. These words or symbols can also include slogans, letters, numbers, or even sounds. So long as they clearly identify the source of a product or service and distinguish it from all others. That's how trademarks protect the public, by preventing confusion or deception by those who try to palm off their goods as those of another. Trademarks also protect the reputation of the producers of those goods and services, and can be very valuable in marketing and advertising. Take Nike's swoosh logo. In 1971, Nike founder Phil Knight paid graphic design student Carolyn Davidson a mere $35 to design the swoosh logo for his new company. Today, that trademarked logo is indelibly associated with Nike's brand, including its reputation for quality workmanship and design, and it's worth a staggering $20 billion. Don't feel too bad for Ms. Davidson, though. Phil Knight later gave her stock worth an estimated $750,000. Not bad for a few hours' work drawing a curvy checkmark.
Okay, so there you get a flavor of the videos, and they introduce the topic and then provide examples throughout in order to really root the concepts in real world examples and companies that we can all recognize. And so Nike's trademark in this instance. Leah, just checking in that you can still see the presentation okay?
Yep, still can.
Okay, wonderful. So another resource available to you are ready-made presentation slides. We have 30-minute and 60-minute slide formats that you can use for a new presentation or take bits and pieces to include in maybe one of your existing presentations. The PowerPoints also come with outlines where we include more background and definitions on the topics that are introduced in the slides in more detail for you to reference. And so we have several of those slide presentations. Again, you can find those on our educator portal. So moving on to some of our self-paced resources that you can share with students. Those that want to dive deeper into the topic of IP, I think a great self-paced resource is our online course on Udemy. It's called Intellectual Property Inventors, Entrepreneurs, Creators. And we've seen many examples of educators assigning this online course as a precursor, maybe for certain courses, and also as an opportunity for extra credit. So the course was developed to provide a working knowledge on all the basics of IP, and we've had over 12,000 individual learners and entrepreneurs from both formal and from informal educational backgrounds and contexts take the course. It's also the best rated free IP course on the platform, so we're really proud of the feedback we've gotten on it, and it's about 3.5 hours of content. Again, it's available for free on udemy.com. So I'm going to play another quick clip here so you get a sense of the online course and also the difference between the style of the course versus the basics of IP video series that we just previously watched a clip of. So I'll play that now.
What is a copyright? A copyright is an intellectual property right granted by a government to the author of an original literary, dramatic, musical, artistic, or other eligible creative work. It gives the creator the exclusive right to control how the work is published, reproduced, performed, or displayed. It also allows the creator to control whether or not derivative works, such as a movie adaptation of a novel, may be produced. In the U.S., the founders set the legal foundation for copyright in the Constitution, in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 8. This clause gives Congress the authority to promote the progress of science and useful arts by securing for limited times to authors and inventors the exclusive right to their respective writings and discoveries. Congress and the courts have interpreted the terms authors and writings very broadly. This allows them to protect many different types of creators and content. Title 17 of the U.S. Code allows copyrights to be granted to the authors of original works of authorship, including books, plays, choreography, graphic or audiovisual works, sound recordings, and architectural works. Typically, a copyright lasts for the life of the author plus 70 years. How does an author obtain a copyright?
Okay, so that's just a brief clip that I wanted to play so you get a sense of the online course. It definitely dives deeper into each topic area than the shorter basics of IP video series, and it's a little bit more of a traditional format there. Leah, just checking in that you can still see the presentation on your end.
It looks great.
Okay, thanks. So I'd also like to highlight a section that's on our website. It's called Hot Topics in Intellectual Property as another self-paced resource. These are topics that are also embedded in our ebook and course content, but this goes a little bit more in depth, and these are articles and mini case studies that help ground IP understanding in real world examples. So for instance, do infringers pay for the whole product or the infringing component? That article explores the topic of Apple suing Samsung for infringing on their iPhone design patent. So that's a case that we can all really think of, you know, really off the top of our heads, a great example of infringement and how has that worked out in the real world. And we'll be releasing new topics soon. We have a new case we're releasing. It's a copyright law case that Google and Oracle are currently battling out right now. So that one should be really, really interesting and will be decided later this year. In addition to these hot topics that I have up on the screen right now, we've recently launched an IP 101 blog that you can find at michelsonip.com. And those are also addressing typical questions that entrepreneurs have around the fundamentals of IP. So for example, our first post was called Top 5 Things Every Entrepreneur Should Know About Copyrights. And we have a new blog out monthly, so I'd encourage you to check that out as well. And you can share that as another resource for students. Okay, now on to embedding digital IP materials into your online resources. I quickly wanted to mention and show how some institutions are using our materials to augment their own online resources. Here, I have up on the screen an example from the University of Oregon's Tech Transfer Office. So they've embedded Vimeo links from the Basics of IP video series, which you saw a clip of earlier, into their copyright management page and several other pages that they have, and they share these resources along with their own content. And here are more examples. NACI, of course, and Lemelson MIT, that program, and Kalamazoo Community College are other groups that we've seen do this. And usually we'll see these groups sharing our video series links or links to the online course. And it's a great way to bolster content that you've already created and have it live among your digital assets. I just want to reiterate again that our resources are not only free, but also openly licensed. And so we really encourage this sort of use from programs and institutions. If you can find a way to embed these resources, we're happy to see you do that. Okay, and on to hosting a hacking IP event. So this is the last tip in our five ways to empower your students with IP education, hosting a hacking IP event. This is an event series we launched that's focused on fostering community and growing networks around the topic of IP. And we see it as a nexus for colleges, for small business centers, for accelerators and incubators, private sector companies, local IP professionals, legal organizations, to all engage together on this topic area. And so each event features a panel of regional IP experts, and they focus on sharing critical advice and IP lessons with the audience. Often there's an IP attorney, there might be a professor that's taught IP, there might be an entrepreneur, and so a diverse group of panelists that can really speak to the different the IP journey differently. And we launched it here in California in 2018. We've had events with Babson College, Santa Monica College, and Santa Rosa Junior College, but we are regionally agnostic and partnered with community colleges in North Carolina, for example, and we hope to bring it to additional states soon as well. So you can see here the logos of many of the schools that we've partnered with on this so far. Here's a photo from our Babson event that was in San Francisco. And we do provide technical assistance and financial support for these events. So you can learn more about this and you can apply to host one of these on our website, michelsonip.com/partners. Given the current climate, and we all know everything going on right now, we are more than happy to accommodate a digital format as well, or a webinar style in place of an in-person event. But, you know, we'll still have the hacking IP panelists, regional experts to speak to these topics. So to close out here, we have some testimonials on our work, and these are all from the NACI community. I really like the one that says, suddenly IP law is not only palatable but fun, because that's really the idea here. We strive to close the IP education gap, democratize access to this information for the benefit of our students, and to make it something that's, you know, really exciting to engage with. We have another quote here, at least a dozens of our clients have applied for trademark and copyright protection. And you know, those are the stories that we want to hear, and that's so wonderful, and that's the goal of all of this. So great testimonials from the NACI community. The impact of our initiative so far, over 250 colleges and universities using our curriculum and materials. We have over 12,000 individual learners online and over 25,000 students across campuses. And lastly, I would like to thank the NACI community for partnering with us on this initiative. We're so grateful for the opportunity to engage with such a dynamic community. You can see here we have 63 NACI colleges right now using our curriculum, and that number is always steadily growing. Also have some stats here from the initial pilot with NACI, where we found that 95% of students believe that IP education is valuable for entrepreneurs after accessing these resources, and that's just awesome. So we just love being a part of this community, and thank you again. So here's my information. Please feel free to reach out to me with your thoughts and questions. I know, unfortunately, we weren't able to have our faculty partners on today, but we can always connect you with them to share more about how they're using the curriculum. And so yes, my information is there, and please feel free to reach out to me anytime. And with that, I'll turn it back to you, Leah, for Q&A.
Perfect. Thank you, Jelani. That was great. I'm just getting my screen back up here. Hold on one second. Alrighty, so like Jelani mentioned, we'll move into the Q&A portion of our webinar. So I know that a couple folks were chatting me earlier about the slides and the recording. So just to reiterate, yes, this session is being recorded and you will receive both the slides as well as the recording in about 24 hours from now. And then as well, if you're an AC member, you can always log in on NACI.com to our webinar archive, where you can visit all of those previous webinars and slides as well. Jelani, would you be able to go into a little bit more depth about the Hacking IP event and what that might look like if it was kept virtual versus in person?
Absolutely. We don't have any examples of that quite yet, but we're very open to working with groups to organize a event. We'd like to still keep it panel style. As I mentioned before, we have we've traditionally had a IP attorney, an educator, an entrepreneur, and other profiles, innovators, to join the panel. And so I would envision it being a webinar style. We'd have the panel format with some preset questions, and then we'd have opportunity for Q&A outside of that. And you know, many of these, many of the people that would be interested in being on the panel would also, I'm sure, share their contact information for questions even outside of the webinar. So, but yeah, we don't have any examples of that so far. So we'd definitely work with the group to figure that out.
Okay, perfect. And so is the best way to partner with you to do that just to fill out that form on your website, or what's the best way to go about starting that process?
Yes, absolutely. Fill out the form on our website. It's just a quick Google form, and we will set up a call after that and talk through some of the ideas.
Okay, perfect. It sounds like we'll have at least one or two folks from the webinar today that are interested in doing that. So that's great to hear. Alrighty, and then Jelani, a couple other questions here too. At what point in a course do you recommend introducing the topic of IP?
So when to introduce IP? It really depends on the subject matter. For SMC's Law for the Entrepreneur class, I know that they teach employment law and contracts before going into IP. So they have quite a bit to get through before they introduce the topic of IP. For other partnerships we've had, for example, with entrepreneurship programs that are teaching to the business model canvas, after talking about customer and competitive advantage is usually a great time to talk about IP and how you plan to defend that advantage, that unfair advantage. And so I'd say it depends. If you send us a specific case or course you're thinking about, we're always happy to make that recommendation or to share how other programs are doing it.
Perfect. Okay, thank you. And just as a reminder to everyone, I saw a couple people raise their hands. If you wouldn't mind typing in your question via the chat feature or the question feature on your GoToWebinar dashboard, that's the best way to answer questions. If you would like me to unmute you, I can do that as well, but would prefer you just to write those questions in. All right, let's go to the next question. So Jelani, if everything is free, is there some sort of an openly licensed, is there some sort of catch, or what is the foundation's ask?
Yes, this is a question that we get a lot. Yes, everything is free, everything is openly licensed. Our Our activities are underwritten by the foundation, as I mentioned before, and our only ask is that we build a relationship where you're able to report back on your usage and share your feedback. So we send out surveys maybe about once a year, sometimes twice, through a really simple Google form. And we're looking for impact metrics and understanding how many students and innovators have been touched. Our founder, Dr. Michelson, wants to see, and we all want to see, that this is truly impacting your students, and we sustain our activities based on that feedback. And so that's really the only ask. Keep in touch with us, share your stories with us. You know, those quotes, we love those quotes. We love constructive feedback. What is missing? What are the gaps in our own curriculum? And we just want to keep working in partnership to develop it even further.
Okay, awesome. And I know that I've done some outreach to our NAC members in regards to collecting feedback. And so would just encourage everyone on the call, if you do currently use the Michelson IP resources, we'd love to hear from you and either highlight your story or share that feedback with the foundation to continuously improve the content and materials. And then as well, if you're doing specific things in your classroom with materials or even with different IP materials, we'd love to share that as well too, to really make this little community of practice and really be able to share best practices. Okay, and then Jelani, one other question. What other IP materials or resources are part, obviously, from your great resources on michelsonip.com would you recommend?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. And there are a lot of useful resources out there. I would check out the USPTO website, of course, uspto.gov, particularly around patents. And they have some programs worth looking into. One is called the Patent Pro Bono Program. I believe it's for independent inventors and small businesses where you might be eligible for free or for reduced costs for legal assistance. Similarly, check out the USPTO Law School Clinic programs. I recently heard that there are a number of law school clinics that are able to share advice, and so I'd recommend looking into that a little bit further, and I want to check those out as well. For those in California, California Lawyers for the Arts offers educational programming, and I know they definitely touch on the topic of IP and related topics. So you can look there for resources, pro bono programs with individual state bar associations. A resource that I really like and that we're partnered with actually here at Michelson IP is ipwatchdog.com. They have an inventors tab with wonderful tutorials for things like patent searches and confidentiality agreements and a host of other additional topics. IPwatchdog.com, they are really a great news source for everything in the world of IP, but they also run webinars, and they have some tutorials and resources online that you can check out. And so, yeah, this is a great question. We're actually working on an article to share some of these additional resources or programs with our community here. So Leah, I can absolutely reach out to you and share that when it's ready as well, because there's so much out there and we definitely want to make sure that everyone knows the resources that are available to them even beyond Michelson IP.
Awesome. Yeah, that'd be great. We're happy to share that through our network as well. And just one other kind of comment or question for you as well, Jelani. Could you just go over again the license at which allows folks to use your content and curriculum freely? Just wanted to clarify that with some comments as well.
Yeah, so the materials are, I think they're currently licensed a bit differently, but they're all under the Creative Commons, the various CC BY licenses. And so you can usually see those within our website, but if you're having problems accessing that, we also have the license on the educator portal, then feel free to reach out to me. We can talk through that, but they're the Creative Commons licenses.
Perfect. Okay, thank you. And then just to reiterate, so I know, John, you just gave a great list of additional resources as well, too, and she referenced that they're working on a blog post for that. So as soon as that's done, we'll make sure that we publish that through or push it out through our NACI communication channels, but would encourage you guys to take a look at their blog as well, too, because a lot of folks are writing in that they would like a list of all those resources you mentioned, Jelani.
Oh, awesome. Okay, absolutely. We'll keep in touch when that is ready.
Okay, perfect. All right, so let's, all right. So we have one more comment, which is a fun one to hear. Ravi shared that he has shared the Michelson IP ebook, and he actually did have one of his students submit an IP application. So the student shared that the ebook was very helpful in that process. So there you go, a testimonial on the fly as well too. So thank you so much for sharing that, Ravi.
Thank you. That's awesome. I would love to hear more about that offline. That's really great to hear.
Well, great. Well, Jelani, I'll just give you one last chance to share any more comments with our audience today. If not, I'll go ahead and wrap up the webinar then.
Sure. Just thank you again, everyone, for joining us today for this webinar. These are five ways to empower your students with IP education, but there are many more. And so please stay connected with us, share your thoughts as well, and just look forward to staying connected. And thanks again, Leah, for the opportunity.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jelani. We want to thank you, the foundation, as well as the folks from Santa Monica College that weren't able to join us today, but like we shared earlier, they'd be happy to touch base with anyone that wants to connect with them offline because they were very instrumental in getting this pilot moved forward. And then also just wanted to share that we'd love to hear from all of you on the line. Thank you so much for sharing your time with us today. We hope that you found this webinar to be valuable. So please look for a follow-up survey as you exit the webinar as well too. So with that being said, this webinar is now complete. Hope everyone has a great rest of their afternoon.